start. I do not agree with such an attitude. I think it is a matter for the Lok Sabha to consider very carefully where all this is leading us to, quite apart from the state's reorganization report. In great cities and elsewhere, there are always antisocial elements, gundas and the like. One can deal with them if society generally disapproves of them, as it does. But when society approves of violent methods, then the gundas can immediately have the chance of their lifetime. The major question in India today, internally speaking, is that what is going to be our policy in regard to this growing violence? I am not afraid of the violence of the hooligan, but of the spirit of violence. 2 days ago, on the occasion of the funeral procession in Lucknow of Narendra Dev, a person beloved of all, a policeman was blinded and others were badly injured. Why should this happen? A funeral procession should be an occasion for solemnity. Instead, some people threw stones and pushed about, and a poor policeman lost an eye completely, apart from some police officers being rather badly injured by stones. I cannot understand this. We in India appear to have a split personality. We speak undoubtedly about non-violence, about our culture and Sanskriti, while in our daily behavior we are coming down to a level which is not a civilized level at all. A hartal may be quite legitimate as an expression of opinion in a certain set of circumstances, but may become dangerous and objectionable in another set of circumstances. And I say that at the present moment, with these big tensions and bitterness prevailing in various parts of India, it is not patriotic, it is not wise, it is not reasonable to do anything which may lead to violence, even if the government is at fault. May I say a few words about the state's reorganization business? Slightly less than 2 months ago, we discussed the matter in this Lok Sabha. There was a very full debate, and I ventured to give expression to my own approach to this question then too. As I have watched developments in various parts of the country, I have been troubled not by this occurrence or that, but by the atmosphere that is being gradually created. The main problem before me has been how to meet the challenge of the growing violence and bitterness. How can we possibly check it? How can we possibly soothe it? Some honorable members have referred rather caustically to some kind of a dictatorial approach by 4 men of the Congress committee who are supposed to lay down this and that. What exactly is the procedure we followed? I referred to it on the last occasion and to the multiplicity of these problems. I also pointed out that the problem usually was not one between the central government and a certain group or a certain state, but between two groups or states. Some honorable members are perhaps not well acquainted with the development of the Congress outlook on the subject of linguistic provinces. Undoubtedly, in the 20s, we were strongly in favor of all work being done in the language of the area in order to enable the local people to play their part. Insofar as the importance of the language in doing work is concerned, we hold to the same principle. But let us not mix up two things, namely the importance of the development of a language and linguistic boundaries. The two are not the same thing. If you see the Congress resolutions of the last 3 or 4 years, you will find that all of them have stated quite clearly that language is an important factor, but that there are other economic, geographical, and developmental factors which are equally important. Finally, the most important factor, the overriding factor, is the unity of India. That is what the Congress has been saying all along. Now, seeing all that has happened since the publication of the SRC report, naturally and even more than previously, our thoughts have gone towards laying a greater stress on the unifying factors. We have been discussing the 5-year plan and thinking more and more in economic and developmental terms. Take Bengal and Bihar. The area between Bengal and Bihar is the richest industrial area of India, and no doubt in a few years' time it will grow into the most heavily industrialized area. For developmental reasons, it was of very great advantage to Bihar and Bengal to work that area jointly. We have had enough experience in the last 5 years of small matters being delayed because two governments had to deal with them and pulled in two different directions. I am merely pointing out that in this case there were valid reasons. Everywhere you will find that the economic approach has now to be considered much more than previously, always making sure that the language approach is also there, not as a boundary, but for the purpose of doing work in that language and seeing that the cultural aspect of language is always encouraged. Occasionally, it may be that two languages overlap. Suppose Bengal and Bihar form a union. Nothing will happen to the Bengali language or to the work done in Bengali. Nothing will happen to the Hindi there. I wish to say something about Bombay. It is quite wrong for us to go about censoring any community or group for what has happened. That is a wrong approach. There is no doubt what has happened in Bombay is disgraceful. In a similar situation in any other country, the army and tanks would have come in, but in Bombay only police force was used. Bombay has been a tragedy for all of us, but recrimination does not help. I think I should mention just one thing which should be borne in mind by all of us, namely the trend towards violence. Stop.